You're watching ADTV.
Before we start this evening's lecture, let us say a prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, this is a very sensitive topic, and I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings, but I pray that you will be with us and that your Spirit will be here and that you will enlighten us and to use your word to discern truth from error. Thank you for all that you have done for us. Thank you for your blessings and your protection. And we commit this meeting into your hands. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Charisma of the Spirit. What is that all about? Well, the Bible says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." That's a theme all the way through the Bible. All the way through the Bible. "And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter," referring to the Holy Spirit, "that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth." John 14, 15 and 17. This Spirit, this Holy Spirit, is not a spirit of error. And if we look at that previous part of that verse, you will see it says, "If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray to the Father, and he shall give you another comforter." So there is a condition. You have to be obedient to God, and you will receive the comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth. So the Holy Spirit will lead one into truth, not error. And the Holy Spirit and error are mutually exclusive. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Just there, just on that one verse alone. Whosoever, all dispensationalism, all pre-selection, all these features just disappear. Whosoever, anyone has access to Christ. 1 John 1:7, "But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another." So if you are in Christ, if you are in fellowship with him, then you are in fellowship with his comforter, you receive his comforter, and fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. There's no halfway measure. There's no cleansing after death. You are cleansed. Acts 1 verse 8, "But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you." Now what is this power? What is this power? Is this something that I can be Superman, you know? Do stuff that nobody else can do? To receive power is to be equipped for the task. God has an instruction for his people. God says, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel." And the gospel is not a very popular thing in the world, so there is opposition. But God says, "Go into the world and preach it, and I will empower you to do that." So where does the power come from? It comes from God. It's not something that I have that I can boast with or say, "Wow, look at me, I'm Superman." No, no, no. This is something that you receive from God, and it is conditional to obedience. But today in the world, We have many who claim to be the people of power, and they walk around saying that they can do this and they can do that. They might mention the name of Jesus, but they still claim that they have this power to walk through walls, to crush whatever opposition there is. And the world out there is experiencing a reform in terms of religion, such as has not been seen since whenever. Let's have a look at the function of the Holy Spirit to make sure whether all this is in accordance with what the Scriptures teach. The Holy Spirit convicts of sin. And when He, that's the Holy Spirit, is come, He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. John 16, verse 8. So the Holy Spirit firstly convicts one of sin. The first thing you have to realize when you come into the presence of Christ is that you are a sinner and that you are bankrupt, that you have nothing. Blessed are the poor in spirit, says the Lord. Blessed are the poor in spirit. That means you must realize your own bankruptcy. You have nothing to offer. And then you will receive mercy. And then you can go through the Christian procession as it is depicted in the Beatitudes. So the Holy Spirit will convict of sin, but the world doesn't want to know about sin. They want to hear that Jesus paid for sin and therefore everything's all right. I'm all right. But the Holy Spirit will convict the heart that we need to turn. Remember Dr. Robert Schuller, Hour of Power? I don't think anything has been done in the name of Christ that under the banner of Christianity that has proven more destructive to human personality and hence counterproductive to the evangelism enterprise than the often crude, uncouth, and unchristian strategy of attempting to make people aware of their lost and sinful condition. Now that's the exact opposite of the function of the Holy Spirit. This might work well to fill up huge holes. Truth has always battled. Jesus, in fact, after preaching great and wonderful truths, looked around him and the people said, "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept this? Who can take this?" And one by one they turned around and what did they do? They left. And then there were only the disciples left, and Jesus looked at them and says, "Do you want to leave also?" And the disciples looked at him and said, "But Lord, you have the words of eternal life. Where should we go? There is nowhere else to go." So, full halls, masses of people. Well, it's easy if you preach. They don't have to worry about sin. It's very easy. If you just preach acceptance and all these things, but keep my commandments and come into conformity with the will of God, that's a different gospel altogether. Let's see the Larry King live interview with Robert Schuller on Christmas Eve 1999. Larry King asking why he met the Grand Mufti. That's the head of the Muslim church. "And why are you here? The idea of bringing religions together, right?" Schuller, "Absolutely. That's what he wants to do. We're in a totally new era. The age of being able to indoctrinate people is finished. Christianity, no different to any of the other. We've got to get all the people together. We've got to preach love, reconciliation. And that's the idea. Bring them all together." King, "Does this visit, Robert Schuller, give you encouragement? The fact that you met the Grand Mufti of the Muslim world?" "Oh, absolutely. The Grand Mufti said, religion is like rain that falls. The extremists pollute the pure water. I predict we're going to focus in the next millennium as religious leaders to clean up the pollution in religion." There's the bottom line. The next war. Now, I don't have to be a prophet to tell you this. The next war is about religion. And all extremists will have to be eradicated by whatever means possible. And of course, the best way to get the mindset of people into that mold is to say, well, let's get rid of those first that are obviously dangerous. I have no problem with putting people away who are dangerous, who cause damage and break the commandments of God, which say you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I mean, that is terrible. That is disgusting. It's unbiblical. But eventually it will filter down to those who say, thus says the Lord, and I stand by it. Mm-hmm. Watch it. It'll happen. And we've already got a name for them. When it comes to the turn of the Christians that stand by the Bible, they will be called Christofascists, or the new fascists. We dealt with that last time. So this is a very serious situation that we are facing here, and this is a very unbiblical situation. Evangelism, and this, something totally different. In fact, it's not evangelism at all. And evangelism is preaching the gospel of salvation in Jesus Christ and redemption from sin, not in sin, by Jesus Christ. Though he were a son, yet learnt he obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them. What does it say there? What does it say there? He became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Hebrews 5, verse 8 and 9. So let's get this thing straight from the beginning. Is there a condition that we have to fulfill if we want to partake in the saving grace that Christ offers us free of charge? Yes or no?
Obedience.
Obedience. Yes. Obedience. And that is where the Holy Spirit comes in. The Holy Spirit says he will lead us to obedience. If we love him, we will keep his commandments. If we don't, then we are not true to the gospel. And if the world preaches another gospel of do what thou wilt is the whole of the law, that's fine. Just accept Jesus and you're all right. You might fill the hall that way. You'd have a lot more people than I have here tonight, that's for sure. The Holy Spirit strengthens us against temptation. God doesn't leave you alone and say, there, battle with sin. Known sin silences the Spirit of God. Psalms 51:11, cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Psalms 51:11. That's fascinating. There are people that preach that the Holy Spirit wasn't around in the Old Testament. It's something new. Well, has God been divided or part of him impotent all these eons, yes or no? Of course, God has quickened people from the beginning with his Spirit. So, if we have known sin in us, David prayed the Psalms after he had this side fling with Uriah's wife. And he felt that the Spirit of God had withdrawn from him because of his sin. And he repented and he said, Lord, don't take your Spirit from me. And the Lord granted him his wish and forgave him because of a sincere heart. He repented. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. So who is the one who helps us to overcome sin? Christ, not us. Not us. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from great transgression. Psalms 19, verse 13. So we have to play a part, and even in that part, Christ gives us the strength to go through with it. And God says, I will not let you be tempted beyond what you can endure. And there is no temptation that we cannot endure because God has promised so. And Samuel said, has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, than to hearken than the fat of rams. 1 Samuel 15:22. It's very important. This obedience thing goes right through the Old and the New Testament. Let's go to the New Testament, John 14:26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. So there's a teaching process. You'll have to learn what the Word of God is all about and bring all things to your remembrance. Now, you can only remember what you've learned. So, you will have to partake of the Word. You will have to make the Word your own. And then the Lord will assist you. Whatsoever I have said unto you. John 14:26. So, the Comforter is Word-based. Bottom line, he's Word-based. So, the Holy Spirit leads us into truth. And we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost. Now listen carefully. Whom God has given to them, and there we have it again in Acts 5:32, who what? Obey him. You cannot separate obedience from the function of the Holy Spirit. So is it possible for someone who has no repentance, who for curiosity's sake goes to a huge church meeting, stands over there, listens, gets slain in the spirit, there he falls over, doesn't have the foggiest idea about 10 commandments, obedience, nothing, and now he's a born-again Christian. Does that make sense? Is this in accordance with what we see over here? Well, let's read on. The Holy Spirit would bring individuals to repentance of sin, guiding them in a fuller understanding of the truth about God and Jesus Christ. Luke 24:46-49, John 14:15, the whole chapter, 14, 15, and 16. Read those. They are phenomenal. Obedience and the Spirit, obedience and the Spirit, obedience and the Spirit. The commandments and the Spirit, the commandments and the Spirit, the commandments and the Spirit. Inseparable. Acts 1:1-4. That is the bottom line. Then the fulfillment is to benefit those brought into the church by the gospel witness. John 17:20, Acts 2. And we will go into this in a little bit more detail. So the Spirit is there to benefit others, so that you can be equipped to witness for them. It's not a selfish thing. Yes, it leads us to repentance. Yes, it helps us to study. Those are things which strengthen us, but the function eventually, the power of the Spirit, is to witness unto others. The timid becomes strong. The gift of tongues was to communicate the gospel to different language groups. Acts 2:2-11 and verse 43. That is the definition. We'll deal with it in detail. In both Acts 2 and Acts 19, we see that tongues and prophecy are associated and thus serve to communicate the gospel. Now, we must understand the word prophesy in the Bible. The word prophecy can be one of two things. The one thing is to be a prophet, and that is to receive visions from the Lord, and then to be a prophet as a consequence, dreams and visions. And there were select few in the Bible that were called to be prophets. To prophesy in the Bible means to preach. To preach the gospel, to present the word of God. Now let's have a look at Babylon. Mystic Babylon had three components, you remember, the dragon. Now we looked at what the New Age teaches and all that sort of stuff. We looked at the teachings of Catholicism. We had the lecture on the wine of Babylon. Now let's have a look at the teachings of some of the structures out there which call themselves Protestant. Revelation 16:13. Then I saw three evil spirits that looked like frogs. Now a frog catches its prey with its mouth. Interesting. Out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, out of the mouth of the false prophets. And then unfortunately it says, they are spirits of demons, performing miraculous signs. And they go out to the kings of the whole world to gather them for the battle of the great day of God Almighty. So these spirits, these evil spirits, go out and they gather everyone into this group. Revelation 19:19, then I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered to make war against the rider on the horse. They're fighting Christ himself and his army. But the beast was captured, that's Catholicism, and with him the false prophet who had performed the miraculous signs on his behalf. So most of the function that goes out into the world out there will come from the false prophet. And the false prophet, the miracles that are done on his behalf, according to Revelation 13, emanate from the beast out of the earth, which we identified as this great country where I am standing right now. And with these signs, he had eluded those who had received the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. So with this great religious fervor, many will be deluded. They will be deluded. They will think that they believe one thing when they believe another. There's nothing worse in the world than deception. Deception is the worst thing that there is. Those mainline blues, religion, America's old God Protestant churches confront an unprecedented decline. People are looking for a new religion. Vatican II defined what that religion should be. Remember, Vatican II said there must be acclamation, there must be response, there must be popular music, there must be movement, there must be emotion. That's what Vatican II said. And the more, the merrier. That is called the liturgy. And Roman Catholicism calls the liturgy the holy liturgy. Can you believe that? The liturgy of that which you do, which you move, which you shout, which you acclaim, which you, whatever you do, that is holy. Well, it could be unholy. It could be every unclean and detestable bird pretending to be the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit convicts of sin and righteousness and judgment, brings you into obedience with God's commandments, and does all kinds of interesting things. So we have full house churches where we have these activities. And we call it a time of refreshing, restoration, a new movement. It all started with Pentecostalism. This man was called Mr. Pentecost, David Duplessis. He was from my own country. I'm surprised to see my little country down there in the southern tip of Africa. What a tremendous contribution that little country, once the greatest Protestant bastion in the whole of Africa, how much that has contributed to this type of religion. Mr. Pentecost, he was the chairman of the World Council of Pentecostal Churches, another prominent man, Howard Brown. He's the one who started the Laughing in the Lord. He comes from my country too. I mean, we export them all the time. We export them to America, and then the Americans export it to the rest of the world. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? So maybe it's time to hear something else from the southern tip of Africa as well. Here you have some of their symbols. You have the triangle, you have the fish. Those are also pagan symbols. Now remember, I told you that Gary H. Kahn, he's no pumpkin, wrote this fantastic book on Route to Global Occupation. He was in fact one of the folks who was invited to come into the council that would form the new world government. He was invited. And he analyzed what this was all about, ancient mystery religion, and Freemasonry and the Illuminati and where it comes from. We'll be dealing with all of that in another lecture on Tuesday night. Don't miss Tuesday night's lecture. It gets interesting. And it comes way back from ancient Babylon and witchcraft, sorcery, divination, spiritism, all of those religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, all of those are involved in that. And the new spiritual technology, flotation tanks, self-hypnosis tapes, subliminal persuasion, everything to meet the taste of every human being. Marxism, American, European secret political societies, international banking elite, and the World Council of Churches. Now, if you want to be very prominent in this world, in terms of meeting the demands of the masses, well, then it's probably good for your career if you belong to these societies. And these societies in their higher echelons, as we have seen from the quotes so far, are Luciferian. They are not the worshippers of Jesus Christ, but they pretend to be the worshippers of Jesus Christ. They even say that it is necessary to deceive the lower ranks, because they wouldn't understand anyway. Marx called them human herds, used them like gun fodder. And the World Council of Churches is working towards the unification of all religions under one umbrella, and that will eventually be controlled, of course, by Roman Catholicism. That is the embodiment of everything we stand for. They are the high priest of the ancient mystery religion. That's why we did the Wine of Babylon. And they are the leaders of every single one of these societies in the background. So the Lord becomes your buddy. And it's the Lord's gym, the sin of the world, bench press. This isn't this disgusting? This comes out of Christian stores. Christian charismatic stores. Do you know this guy? Oral Roberts? Do you know him? Oh. Fresh fire. Miracle convention. We're talking about a fire that comes down from heaven in the sight of men that will set the world alight. But the Bible says, beware of the great manifestation. Oral Roberts University has this emblem. It has the upside down triangle, which, by the way, is the form of the female deity. And then it has the flame of the spirit above there. And the flame, of course, as we have seen, could be the flame of Lucifer. And let's have a look a little further. This is Veith, the word of Veith. The central picture on the front page is the Stella, which is the symbol of Osiris. And over there, Veith is written in the Masonic shield. Very interesting. And all the great preachers, if we look at the Oral Roberts, and we look at Copeland, Kenneth Copeland, and we look at Benny Hinn, and we look at all of those, then it becomes very, very interesting. Let's have a look here. Promise Keepers, for example. July 1997, Kenneth Hagin placed the Masonic obelisk on the cover of his magazine. And all these organizations are gathering and gathering and gathering people. Tulsa, Oklahoma is the... What was that? Oh, let me just read that again. Tulsa, Oklahoma is the headquarters of the Oral Roberts and the Kenneth Hagin group. Now, these are people of power that have a massive acclaim, and they work together with the Benny Hinns and all these great preachers all over the world. Let's have a look what Kenyon has to say in his book about the power of the spirit that he empowers people with. And these books, of course, are used in the ministry worldwide. They are very revered. So this will give us some ideas to the theology. To know that that defeat was administered to him by our substitute and set to our record credit, that's talking about the defeat of Satan, so that in the records of the Supreme Court of the universe, we are the masters of Satan. And that Satan recognizes that in the name of Jesus, we are his rulers. When the heart knows this, as the body knows heat and cold, then faith is unnecessary. Interesting. Interesting that in the courts of heaven, in the records of the Supreme Court of the universe, we are the masters of Satan. That's pretty powerful stuff. Wow. Let's go on. Page 92. We know that God himself put Satan and all his ability beneath our feet, and we are looked upon by the Father and by Satan as masters of the dominion of darkness. That's interesting. I don't want to be a master over the dominion of darkness. Thank you. 1 Corinthians 15:25. For he, who's that? Jesus, must reign till he has put all enemies under his feet. Hebrews 2:6-9. What is man that you are mindful of him? You have put all things under his feet, but now we do not yet see all things put under him, but we see Jesus. So there's a little shift in emphasis here. Where does all power lie? In Christ. And if you have this little shift of emphasis and all power lies in you, then you are stepping on the grounds of presumption. Romans 16:20, and the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet. What does it say there? Shortly. When will that happen? When Christ returns, this enemy will be put aside. Let us not be presumptions and go out there and say, hey, Satan, come here, I want to give you a blood nose. Did you know that some people tried that in New Testament times? And what did the Spirit do to them? He gave them such a beating, they walked out of there and didn't know what they were doing. Is it possible that we have some form of deception going on over here? Let's have a look. We are taking Jesus' place. No, no, no. You can represent Jesus, but you can never take his place. Amen. He came to destroy the works of the adversary. We are completing the work that he began. No ways. That's presumption. You are a victor. He made you one. Get used to it so you can play the part. Page 92. This is power religion. It sounds good. He made us to sit with him in the heavenly, so representatively we are seated on the throne with God. That's in page 93. Well, I have a problem with that. Revelation 3:21. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. Can you see the difference? There's some overcoming to do, and the final victory is his, not mine. I can represent Jesus in fear and trembling, hoping that I will be doing the right thing, prayerfully saying, Lord, help me. Even the disciples made mistakes, yes or no? They sure did. Paul rebuked Peter to his face. So if the head is exalted, the body is exalted. Well, now you get puffed up, you see. If he conquered all the forces of darkness and left them paralyzed and broken before he arose from the dead, it is as though we had accomplished that mighty work. Now it's getting a bit nasty, don't you think so? Well, that is power religion. That's what it's all about. That authority and that ability belongs to the believer. No, no, no. The believer has access to that authority and that power, but it doesn't belong to him. It belongs to Jesus Christ. The recreated man is supernatural. He is Superman. Now, that is a very problematic theology. The Toronto experience. All over the world, you have that great experience. And the man who brought it about is this one. You know what he's called? You know what his nickname is, Rodney Howard Brown? You know what his nickname is? He's called the Holy Spirit Barman. The Bible says something about the wine of Babylon. Do you think he could be pouring wine that is not biblical? Thumping around, shouting. This one is a very interesting man, Reinhard Bonnke. Do you know about him? Have you heard about Reinhard Bonnke? Oh, okay. He is the equivalent, they've divided the world up into portions. He is the equivalent for the mass media, what Benny Hinn is to the television media. Benny Hinn gets the television showcase, and he gets the media through the electronic media. Reinhard Bonnke gets the media through mass performances. He doesn't speak to little groups like I am doing now. He speaks to millions. He doesn't book a hall because they don't fit into the halls where he speaks. He speaks in valleys. So he books a valley in Africa, a whole valley. And in that valley, they put up super speakers all along the line. And then literally millions come and listen. Millions. He's got a lot of energy, and it's all power religion. Now, maybe some of these preachers are very sincere, but I have a feeling that some of them are deliberately deceiving. I have a feeling that some of them are Masonic, that they are plants, and that they actually serve another master. Well, laughing in the Lord. Unzip a heaven, Lord, ha ha ha, ho ho, he he. Old and young, weeping, emotion, rolling on the floor, screaming, laughing. We have some churches in our country where if you go past there, they actually come rolling out of the door. Doodle-doodle-doodle-doo, down the stairs. They hurt themselves. They have to be taken home by someone because they're so drunk they cannot take themselves. And they're not drunk from literal wine either. So you have people screeching and howling and screaming at each other, rolling on the floor. Greasley Senior Elder Covenant Life Church report that for the last 3 weeks at every meeting of the church, large or small, there has been an outpouring of the Spirit of God. People have been falling over, laughing uncontrollably, rolling around drunk, crying deeply. We have been unable to stop some meeting, he says, because the people don't want to stop praising God or leave his presence. Interesting. It is a refreshing, it is a festive. Drink, 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 and everyone is getting drunk. Doesn't that sound like the wine of Babylon to you? Isn't God the God of order? Not with Tesla's best bitter or Carling Black Label, but with the Holy Spirit, a giant party is taking place. God is on the move. He's empowering his people. Reports are coming in daily. People are being healed by the human agency. The Holy Spirit is doing a sovereign work. 1 Corinthians 14:40, let all things be done decently and in order. Speaking in tongues is a common phenomenon. On the one hand you have this, and on the other hand you have a sexual showdown. Bishops of the Episcopal Church tacitly embrace the new morality. Where is the obedience to the law of God together with the proclamation? The great preachers of the Pentecostal movement, some of them found in the back seats of cars with prostitutes and pornography, and then everybody can fall. I'm not saying everybody can't fall, but this is a common phenomenon, a common thread that runs through it. And then they apologize and carry on, and then next week you hear about it again, and they say, oh, forgive me, and the millions of dollars stream in. Doesn't sound quite right to me. And then you have the worshiping with the hands moving. In the ancient mosaic, you see that sun worship was associated with the open hand and the swaying of the hands. And here are some of the forms of sun worship where we can see this. Suraya Maska, and the open hand worship system, worshiping towards the sun. Now, people might be deceived. Sun dance on the rampart of the 13th century sun temple at Konarak, India. Four dancers represent the four directions. Some of the practices involved with these religions are such that I do not wish to mention them. Here I'm showing you some of these sculptures around this temple, erotic sculptures on the 13th century sun temple at Konarak and on the 11th century sun temple at Kajaviral, whatever, India. They're so disgusting that I will not show them to you. I've censored them all. But the worst of the worst is right there. The very worst of the worst. And this is religion. This is the age-old cult religion that used to exist with temple prostitution and temple priests that were temple prostitutes. The drums in the African culture are dedicated to the sun god. Here you have the African Kuba Bushong drum with the open hand. A universal solar symbol. This is not from me. This doesn't come from me, by the way. There you have the sun relics over there. This comes from UNESCO itself. The United Nations is propagating this form of worship. We saw last night what they are doing worldwide. Now let's have a look whether the teaching of these great preachers, whether that is in line with the Bible or whether it is in line with the language of the serpent in the beginning. Let's have a look at Kenneth Copeland. You know him, don't you? Okay, I'm just checking. When Jesus cried, "It is finished," he was not speaking of the plan of redemption. There were still 3 days and nights to go through before he went to the throne. This is Jesus Our Lord, Glory, Believer's Voice of Victory magazine, da-da-da-da. He, Jesus, is suffering all that there is to suffer. There is no suffering left apart from him. He's emaciated, poured out, little wormy spirit is down in the bottom of that thing, hell, and the devil thinks he's got him destroyed. Believer's Voice, Victory Program, 11/21/1999. Now let me tell you something about Luciferians. Very often they represent Jesus Christ as the one that they are serving, but he's another Christ. Lucifer, the Christ, who is the conqueror and the one who eliminated and beat up Jesus Christ, and they're proud of it. All right? So we have to be very careful when we listen. What else does he say? You don't have a God in you, you are one. The Force of Love, audio tape, 1987. Now Peter said, by exceeding great and precious promises, you become partakers of the divine class. All right, are we gods? We are a class of gods. Praise the Lord, TV show, February 5, 1986. Now let's read on. This comes from Following the Faith of Abraham, one side one. That Adam was God manifest in the flesh. That's what Masonry teaches. God's reason for creating Adam was his desire to reproduce himself. I mean, a reproduction of himself, and in the Garden of Eden he did just that. He was not a little like God. He was not almost like God. He was not subordinate to God even. Adam is as much like God as you could get, just the same as Jesus. Adam in the Garden of Eden was God manifest in the flesh. Okay, that's Masonic teaching. That's occult teaching. That's devil worship. That's Luciferian worship. Can I speak straight here tonight, or am I going to get thrown with tomatoes? I didn't say it. Sorry, he said it. I'm just quoting, okay? Let's read on. This is a sermon. This is unbelievable stuff. People must know. The Spirit of God spoke to me and he said, "Son, realize this, now follow me in this and don't let your tradition trip you up." He said, "What tradition?" That's your biblical thinking. He said, "Think this way. A twice born man whipped Satan in his own domain, and I threw my Bible down." I could do that if I really wanted to. "Like that," I said. "What?" he said. "A born again man defeated Satan? The firstborn of many brethren defeated him?" he said. "You are the very image, the very copy of that one." I said, "Goodness gracious, sakes alive." And I began to see what I had gone on in there. And I said, "Well, now you don't mean, you couldn't dare mean that I could have done the same thing?" He said, this is God speaking now, "Oh yeah." Does that sound like God to you? "If you'd had the knowledge of the Word of God that he did, you could have done the same thing, because you're a reborn man too." All right, so you're the same as Jesus. Do you need Jesus if you're the same as he is? You're Superman. You've got it all. That's the religion of Pentecostalism. And whether it's preached in the one garb or whether it's preached in the other garb, it's the doctrine of devils. Well, the manifestations that go along, because when these people speak, the Holy Spirit hits and the people fall over and they speak in tongues and they're slain in the Spirit. Is that a spirit from God or is that a spirit from the devil? If this is the doctrine that goes along with it. Is God the author of confusion? Is God the bedfellow of error? I don't think so. Now, this is very interesting. Kenneth Copeland Ministries. And what have we here? A compass and a square. Do you think he's trying to tell other people something that are in the know? Or do you think that is just pure chance? And I say this with all respect, so that I don't upset you too bad, but I say it anyway. When I read in the Bible where it says, where he says, "I am," I just smile and say, "Yes, I am too." That is so arrogant. That is so sick. So, Kenneth Copeland's ministries, and that ties in with all the other big ones. I'm terribly sorry to say this, but this is Masonic. And these people are therefore Masonic plants, leading millions into deception and error. Now let's just make sure. Here's symbols of Freemasonry in Copeland's Shout magazine for kids. There is the inverted pentagram, the head of Mendes, the goat, Lucifer symbol. You have many symbols, the circle with something coming out of it, very interesting. And then you have the symbols of Freemasonry around the neck over there. And of course they call themselves of light, and you have triangles and all kinds of stuff. That's symbols of Lucifer. Freemason Brigham Young, that was of course the Mormon, says, Adam is our father and our God. That's exactly the same as Kenneth Copeland said. You see, they serve the same master. They were both Freemasons, 33 Freemasons. The one has Mormonism under his belt, the other one has ministries of Kenneth Copeland. Copeland's quote, Adam in the Garden of Eden was God, manifest in the flesh. If it looks like a duck and quacks like a duck and walks like one, must be one, right? Following the faith of Abraham, one side one. Okay? Image of God in you, 3, audio tape 01-1403. God's on the inside looking in. He doesn't have any legal entry into the earth. The thing don't belong to him. You see how sassy the devil was in the presence of God in the book of Job? God said, where have you been? Wasn't any of God's business. He, Satan, didn't even have to answer if he didn't want to. God didn't argue with him a bit. You see, Luciferians teach that Lucifer beat Jesus Christ. They're both, unfortunately, God. They say Adonai, the God of evil and wickedness, which is Jesus, is unfortunately also there. But Lucifer is stronger. He, Satan, didn't even have to answer if he didn't want to. God didn't argue with him a bit. You see, this is the position that God is in. Might say, well, if God's running things, he's doing a lousy job of it. He hadn't been running him except when he's got just, you know, a little bit of a chance. Who's mightier here, Lucifer or God? Lucifer. Now what about this man? He was here just the other day, kept a lot of people away from my meetings. Benny Hinn. Interesting signal picture that he's giving over there. What does he have to say? Christ 2, the Word made flesh, audio tape, side 2, 1991. This is Benny Hinn speaking. Oh, he's a good friend of the man down the road. Did you know that? Okay. Birds of a feather? Okay. I never said it. You said it. Don't tell me you have Jesus. You are everything he was and everything he is and ever shall be. Don't say I have. Say I am, I am, I am, I am, I am. That's a mantra. That's mysticism. That's Luciferian. That's a devil. This is demonic. This is not the gospel. Now let's have a look at the quick video.
It was as though someone plugged me into electricity. My entire body was numb under this awesome feeling of power. And suddenly, a few feet from me, I saw the Lord. He was 6 feet something tall, maybe 6'2", 6'3". Long hair, brown, light brown hair. His eyes, I'll never forget his eyes. They looked right through me. In the morning, I woke up and told my mom, I said, Mom, last night I saw Jesus. And Mom looked at me and she said, well, then you must be a saint.
The first part of the next video is Reinhard Bonnke in Africa preaching to literally millions at a time with these speakers. And then we have Benny Hinn. And there's a BBC interview with Benny Hinn where they accuse him that his tactics are nothing other than hypnosis, and where they have compared it with other hypnotists, and other hypnotists have confirmed that what he is doing is hypnosis. And he doesn't deny it, but he also doesn't acknowledge it. So
at the forefront of the charismatic movement, at least in ratings terms, are two very different men. Reinhard Bonnker, a German, and Benny Hinn, Palestinian by birth, but now commanding the heights of the fiercely competitive business of American television evangelism.
Things are possible to him that believeth. All things are possible to him that believeth. All things, every need, every prayer, all things are possible. All you have to do is believe.
Play that beautiful violin as the gift of the Lord's word, Moses. Thank you.
Ago, Pastor, he had a logging accident. The power of God came upon him tonight.
James McCracken
left his body. He could not walk.
Sadly, James's
steps.
Condition has deteriorated since Portland. Movement is now so painful he can no longer dress himself. But James remains so convinced that a miracle took place that he has refused prescribed medication and the operation his doctor now considers imperative.
Now, this is Mesmer conducting a magnetic seance in the baths. Mesmer, the father of mesmerism, hypnotism, would go up and do that. Now, he was not Christianity at all. He would do that and the people would fall over. Benny Hinn and these great preachers do exactly the same thing. They all have exactly the same technique. Now, in this one, he calls on fire into the audience and they fall over, and he calls on fire onto the choir and his old choir falls over, and then they interview him as to whether this is hypnosis or whether this is not hypnosis. This was a BBC interview, so this is quite good stuff.
The anointing. To personal charisma and well-tried techniques of crowd manipulation, Benny Hinn adds another dramatic ingredient. Actually, it's an old hypnotist trick, and it's been around for hundreds of years.
Fire on the choir. Fire! You must let every guard down.
First, there's the classic hypnotic induction.
You will not protect even your emotions anymore. You become completely open because the anointing demands that every part of you be open. And at those moments, you are extremely fragile and extremely sensitive.
We showed the footage to a professional hypnotist. And he said, and I quote, "This is something we do every day, and Mr. Hinn is a real professional."
Well, I would react by simply saying that these manifestations do happen. Yet, at the same time, the real, the divine, is still there.
I think you got the gist of the matter. There he stands. The BBC confronts him and says, what you are doing is hypnosis, nothing else. He doesn't deny it. He doesn't confirm it. Let's have a look at a summary chart of the slain in the spirit experience. It is a manifestation in the world in Kundalini yoga, which teaches the serpent power, which is released and which gives you that power. So being slain in the spirit and Kundalini yoga, one and the same thing. Subut, Qigong, Shakers, Pentecostals, they all had it. Bible, not one. It was a demonic manifestation. There were demon-possessed that were rolling around, but there was no one in the Bible, Old or New Testament, that experienced it. Uncontrollable laughter, it's part of yoga. Subut, Qigong, Shakers, Pentecostalism, was never mentioned in the Bible. Physical jerks, you saw them jerking there with Benny Hinn. Yoga, yes. Subud, Qigong, Shakers, Pentecostals, yes. Bible, no. Animal sounds, roaring, part of all those systems, Bible, no. Spontaneous movements, all those systems, yes. Bible, no. Revival-like meetings, in other words, where you had this shouting and the screaming and all these things. The Bible teaches that Peter preached and said, repent, return round. And they said, what must we do? Then they said, repent and be baptized. Yes, but this sort of meeting where you shout and scream at the devil and everybody falls over and does this and that and the other, it's not biblical, but it's part of all these cultures from the most pagan right through to Pentecostalism. And speaking in tongues as they do is the same all the way through in all these systems. In yoga they do it, Subud, Qigong, Shakers, all the shamans, the witch doctors, they all speak in tongues, every single one of them. It's a phenomenon. It's also a phenomenon of voodoo, where the lesser god gets into you and you speak in tongues. But Acts chapter 2 defines what speaking in tongues is. Now the greatest evangelist, probably, healing evangelist in the world today, is T.B. Joshua. Who's heard of him? Ah! That's terrible, you know? You know all your American ones? And maybe some of the European ones, but this is the greatest one in all the world. They have jumbo jets leased to fly the people to this man. And he lives in Africa. And listen to his name, he is T.B. Joshua. I was sent to earth to save the world. That's what he says. And Christians from the charismatic movement, they fly by the jumbo jet load to be healed by this man in Africa. Has a giant place which he calls the synagogue. And people stand for days and days and days to get into his presence. And that is him. I'm going to play you a video. I'm going to put the speaker again there, and I'm going to pray to God that you can hear this. What else does he say? He says, the divine person in me can do a million things simultaneously. I can appear to thousands of people in their dreams in any part of the world to set them free of their sickness, problems, and afflictions. That's nice, huh? So what is he? He's God. And look at his poster. He's got Jesus Christ on the cross over there, and then he's got the symbol of the sun with the wavy lines and the straight lines, and he's got the Arabic writing, and it says, there is no deity God except Allah. This is a Christian. This is a Christian, T.B. Joshua, pretending to be a Christian. This is his center, where the people come in their millions, in droves they come to him, white, black, all over the world, and muscular problems, pain, curse, failure. This is a famous footballer. T.B. Joshua, translation of Jesus, Joshua, by the way, is addressed as Emmanuel. God with us. In the synagogue, in the first official video, the song Emmanuel, our God, is repeated over and over whilst the camera focuses on the healings. Whilst driving out a demon, Joshua asked the demon, "And who am I?" The demon answered, "You are Jesus the Christ." Joshua laughed and called the others and said to them, "Hear what this demon says. I'm Jesus the Christ." Now this is a horrendous video.
In the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
It is happening already.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. I will never, never sin again.
It's only the mercy of God that I'm here, and even for me, even more rewarding that I'm healed.
Now people in their millions flock to these people. They flock to these people. And the Bible says, 2 Thessalonians 9, 9-11, the coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those that are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. God didn't leave them without the truth. God rose up the Reformation. People died in their thousands. No, let me say in their millions. To stand for truth. And then they gave it up. And they allowed false apostles to come in and preach a doctrine which is unheard of in the Bible. That you are Superman. That you take the place of Jesus Christ. That you are mightier than the mighty. And that T.B. Joshua, the great healer, says, "I am identified as Jesus Christ. I can get you in your dreams. I can heal you wherever you are. I am so great." It's disgusting. And those that are really sick spend their last cent and they travel there to be deceived by the Benny Hinns and the T.B. Joshuas and the Kenneth Copelands of this world. It's disgusting. Well, they worship Lucifer. Signs and miracles and every sort of evil that deceives those that are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. God showed them who the Antichrist was. God put it on the line. For this reason, God sends them. And this is God's permissive will. You must understand the Hebrew mindset. God has an original will, a permissive will, and an ultimate will. God permits them, in other words, to carry on as they want. They want to be deceived. For this reason, God permits them, in other words, this powerful delusion, so that they will believe the lie, and so that all that will be condemned who have not believed the truth, but have delighted in wickedness. Can I have that mic again here on my machine? And I'll show you something that might just shake you a little bit. I won't show you, I'll let you hear it. Who do they literally worship? You must understand that some of the great music groups in the world that are apparently Christian actually are members of the Church of Satan. And when they sing to the Lord, that Lord could be anyone. What Lord are they singing to? Are they singing to the Lord Jesus Christ, or are they singing to another? When George Harrison wrote and sang the song, My Sweet Lord, that was not Jesus Christ, that was Krishna. That was Krishna, and they were heavy into Luciferian worship, by the way. And in some Christian circles, they don't even bother to hide it. Why should they hide it? They just do it straight out. Have you heard of the group Cowboy Junkies? Christian music produced by Peter Moore, Cowboy Junkies, so and so and so. Where was this recorded? All arrangements by Cowboy Junkies. Captured live at the Church of the Holy Trinity in Toronto, Canada. Right? So this is where the great speaking in tongues movement is going on. And they sing a song called Misguided Angel, and they tell you who the one is that they worship. In this song, don't get caught by the tune. It sticks in your head for some terrible reason. Just throw it out when we're done here. I just want you to hear. It talks about this girl singing and saying, Father, my dad, maybe this guy that I'm with, this one that is over me, is not what you wanted, but he keeps me satisfied. And then it goes on to say, who is the one that is really worshipped? And that's in the chorus, and it says, misguided angel hanging over me. So unlike Gabriel. And then it says, with the soul of Lucifer, I love you to death. I will love you till I die. Interesting what they sing in Christian so-called gatherings. Let's listen to this one. Does that interest you? What is sung in these circles? And there are certain tapes which tell what these preachers actually believe. I don't want to go into that detail, but the name Lucifer is mentioned by name over and over again. Mark 16 and 17, and these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak in new tongues. Luke 24:49, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high, Greek power, skill. Let's go into this study and see what the Bible really teaches. Acts 2:4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men of every nation under heaven. So the gift was given at Pentecost. It was 50 days after the Passover in commemoration of the giving of the law. And there were many, many different language groups in Jerusalem. Acts 2:6. Now when this noise was noised abroad, in other words, when it got known, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard him speak in his own language. 17 languages represented, you can count them there in Acts chapter 2. The word used over there is te idia dialecto, which means mother tongue, in that we were born. Is that a strange unutterable noise, or is it a known language? It's a known language. Acts 2 verse 8, and now hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born. In other words, they spoke it as if they were born into that culture. Acts 2:11, Cretes, Arabians, we do hear them speak in tongues the wonderful works of God, teas, hematreas, glossias, in our languages. In other words, what were they talking about? The works of God. They were preaching. They weren't speaking strange, unutterable sentences. Isaiah 56, 3-5. Neither let the son of the stranger that has joined himself to the Lord speak, saying, the Lord has utterly separated me from his people. Neither let the eunuch say, behold, I'm a dry tree. For thus says the Lord unto the eunuchs that keep my Sabbaths. Here's the obedience part and the Sabbath keeping. And choose the things that please me, and take hold of my covenant, even unto them will I give in my house and within my walls a place and a name better than sons and daughters. And this promise was being fulfilled here in front of the apostles' eyes. Acts 10, 45, 47, and they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, so the Jews were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. That was promised in Isaiah. Here it came. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Was this any different to what the apostles had? No. Then answered Peter, can any man forbid water that these should be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we, or just the same way we did? So, exactly the same way that they had received it, so the Gentiles received it. Acts 19:5, and when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Verse 6 says, and when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came upon them, and they spoke with tongues, and they prophesied, they preached the word of God. That's what it's about. Now, how do the gifts work? And this is very important, because out there we are taught something totally different to what the biblical version is. Out there you are taught, you fall over, you get slain in the spirit, you speak in tongues or whatever, you sit at home and you pray in the spirit and you speak in tongues. Well, 1 Corinthians 12, 1 and 2. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you be ignorant. Ye know that ye were Gentiles, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. When you were in paganism, you did what the Spirit said, like the dumb idol said. In Catholicism, when the bell rings, you go whoop, down on your knees. When the bell rings again, whoop, you get up again. When the priest says, hum di da 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 di da, then you say, oh di da di da do hu. And so you do all these things on a basis as you are led. There's no cognitive function. It is a purely ritualistic thing. Paul says, you know that when you were Gentiles, you were carried along by these dumb idols just as you were led. Whatever they did, whatever they said, that's what you did. Verse 4 and 6 says, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. Now in paganism, there was a different spirit for every gift. So in Catholicism, there are a whole host of saints. And if you have a problem with one form of another, you go to that saint. If you have another problem, you consult the other saint. If you're going to travel, you ask St. Christopher to help you. If you are sick, you go to whoever. You know what I mean? So there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. So now Paul is making a distinction. There are differences of administration, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God who worketh all and in all. So no different gods, no different spirits, one God. Verses 7 and 8, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to what? To profit withal. It's to be of service to others. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. To another faith, to another the gift of healing, to another the working of miracles, to another to prophesy, to preach, to another discerning spirits, to another diverse tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. So question here, does everybody receive the same gift, yes or no? No. No. Everybody does not receive the same gift. Let's read on, verse 11 and 12. But all these worketh that one and the self same Spirit. So the one same Spirit gives all these gifts, dividing to every man severally as he will. So who decides who gets what gift? God decides. For as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body are one, being many, are one body, so also is this church. One body, many gifts. Who gives the gifts? God. Does everybody receive the same gift? No. Verse 18 and 20, but now God has set the members, every one in the body, as it has pleased him. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of thee. And God has set some in the church, apostles, then prophets, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, government, diversities of tongues. So now, is it biblical for a church to say, we all want to speak in tongues? God has set some in the church, first apostles, then prophets, then all the others. So God decides who gets what. Now comes a whole movement out there with people begging God for this manifestation of tongues so that they can feel accepted by God. It's not biblical. It's not biblical. It's not from God. 1 Corinthians 12, 29, 31. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all got the gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? And the way that's written in the Greek says, in the negative. The answer to every one of those is negative. But in paganism, let's put it straight, in Luciferian worship, it was like that. There was slain in the spirit, there was this. We've seen it in all those manifestations. They were there. So, 1 Corinthians 13, 1-5, if I speak with tongues of men and angels but have not love, I am become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. Now, what is the essence of this love? If I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. Firstly, Jesus said, if you love me, do what? Keep my commandments. And if you keep his commandments, he will send you the Comforter. We've looked at all those texts. If I bestow my goods to feed the poor, and if I give my body to be burned, but I have not love, it profiteth me nothing. Listen now carefully. Love suffereth long. It is kind, it envieth not, it vaunteth not itself. It won't say, I'm Superman, I'm tough, I can do whatever I like, I have all power. It is not puffed up, it does not behave unseemly, it seeketh not its own. It's not self-seeking. So if I ask for the gift of tongues for myself, just for my own satisfaction so that I can communicate with God, maybe whatever, I want it for myself. Is that biblical? No. Seeketh not its own, is not provoked, and taketh no account of evil. So, tongues must be interpreted in the light of all these texts. It's not for the self. It's a sign for unbelievers. It was understood. That's the only definition we have in the Bible. It led to a rebirth. It was confirmed by witnesses and was a consequence of the Spirit. And it was not the only sign. There were many signs. In summary, worship is not mindless. 12:1-3. That is a very important principle. If I sing to God, I sing with my heart. I sing with my feelings. There's nothing wrong with that. But I don't give up my mind. I don't give up my mind. And I will not sing a mantra. I will not sing a mantra. We have many mantras in our churches. And we sing them, and I just keep quiet. I won't sing them. I cannot stand some of them, because they're just repetitive rubbish. Worship is not mindless. Number two, principle of usefulness to the whole body of Christ, 12 verse 7. Unity and diverse gifts, 12:10. Everybody has a different gift. The guy standing in front here doing the talking is no more important than the guy doing the recording at the back there. Did you know that? The biblical principle is the one that fights on the front gets exactly the same wages as the one who stays behind and takes care of things behind the front line. God distributes the gifts. I cannot dictate to God what gift I need. Equality and codependence, 12 to 23, and the principle of selfless love, the whole of chapter 13. That is the basis of what we must know. And the power of God, the tools of the trade for the spreading of the gospel, Luke 24, 29. This power is not something that makes me great, makes me puffed up. It's to spread the word of God. That's what it's all about. Ecstatic languages, speaking unknown things, was common in the pagan temples, in Byblos. Plato speaks about it. Plato tells us that a person under divine possession perceived utterances accompanied by visions, not understood by the receiver, which required interpreters. It's ancient. It comes from paganism. It's Lucifer worship. And we've seen that these people quote the devil and not the Bible, not God. These utterances were sometimes accompanied by physical healing by those present. Virgil in 70 to 19 BC tells us that the Sibylline priestess, when in prayer, was overshadowed by the god Apollo, and then she spoke in tongues. Irenaeus talks about glossolalia, the speaking of not understood utterances. He speaks against it in his writings against heresies. And Origen, 185-254 AD, writes of Paul's gift. He writes the following: since then anyone received the knowledge of languages not for himself but for their sake to whom the gospel is to be preached. That was the understanding of tongues all along. So where does this modern manifestation come from? Well, it comes from the Irvinites, experienced glossolalia, the Mormons experienced. These were Masonic founders. These were Luciferians. Father Smith would call upon an illiterate brother to rise and speak tongues in the name of Jesus Christ. But this Jesus Christ is not the Jesus Christ of the Bible. The order was given, arise upon your feet, speak or make some sound, continue to make sounds of some kind, and the Lord will make a tongue or a language of it. History of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And so it came into the church. Modern Pentecostal movement, Kentucky revival, in that there was falling, jerking, rolling, running, whining, whooping, holy laughter, barking, all these things that are not in the order of God. Wow! God was so meticulous about his service, so meticulous that when people did all these funny things, God intervened mightily. The modern Pentecostal movement thus has these manifestations, and Colin Buchanan writes that the emergence of the Church of Rome as partner in the ecumenical discussion and the charismatic union together with us makes it possible for all the churches to become one. The acceptance of Pentecostalism by leaders of the World Council marks the first time that the more traditional Christianity has genuinely welcomed this enthusiastic brand of faith. It comes from Jesuit doctrine. That's where it comes from. Catholics, all of them coming together, the best hope for a renewal of the church in the closing decades of this century. The History of Christianity, page 621. I have news for you. Professor Hollingberger, Birmingham University, also says the same about the charismatic movement, that it brings Roman Catholics and Protestants together. Well, if truth and error come together, then the spirit bringing them together is the spirit of lies, not the spirit of truth. And the union of all the churches that is being brought about by this manifestation is not biblical. But they will quote the scripture to you. They will quote Corinthians and they'll say, there it says you can speak in tongues. Let's understand Paul's epistle to the Corinthians. This is important. This is a Bible study. We have to know where we stand. Corinthians contains references to Paul's first lost letter to the Corinthians. You have to read the first book of Corinthians like you would read a detective story. You have to figure out who's saying what in this book. So there is reference in this book to the lost letter. So Paul is saying, as I wrote to you before, blah, 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 blah. And then there is a Corinthians letter to Paul. They wrote him a letter, and Paul is answering the letter. And now we must read carefully. Is this something that the Corinthians wrote, or is this something that Paul wrote? And then there's Chloe's verbal testimony to Paul, something that somebody told him, Chloe and her household. And then Paul quotes from the literature and the knowledge of the time, just as we do. Put up a quote and say, there, this is what so-and-so says, this is what so-and-so says, this is what so-and-so says. The whole lecture was like that up to now. Now Paul does the same. And you have to figure out which one is doctrine and which one is Paul speaking and which one is someone else speaking. So let's have a look at it further. Here's one of them. I wrote unto you an epistle not to company with fornicators. 5 verse 9. So Paul is referring to another letter that we don't have. So Paul is referring to it, and they are answering that letter. We don't know what Paul said. We have no idea. Now concerning the things wherefore ye wrote unto me, 7 verse 1. So they wrote things to him, and Paul is answering their letter. Now you have to play detective and say, now Paul, did you say this, or is this something that they quoting and asking you to answer? And then, for it has been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions amongst you. 1:11. We don't know what Chloe said either. And then, there's a quote. Food for the belly and belly for the food. That's an Epicurean dictum. Paul is quoting an Epicurean dictum, which might have been quoted in their letter as well. But then he uses the word but to say that he does not agree with the Epicurean dictum. But God will destroy both this and these. Does he agree with that statement? Yes or no? No. So there are many dictums quoted which he quotes out of their letter, and then he says, you say this, I say this. And we know what he says from the buts. But the body is not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body, 6:13. And then there are also quotes from Philo in the writings of Paul. So, now we have to play detective. What did Paul say? What did Paul not say? And the but word is going to become very essential. Now, was he happy with the Corinthians or not? Well, let's read 1 Corinthians 1:11. There are contentions amongst you. And who told him that? Chloe told him that. Verse 12, he says, now this I say, that every one of you who says, I am Paul, I am Apollos, I am Caiaphas, and I am of Christ. Is Christ divided? There were divisions amongst them. Verse 3 of chapter 3, you are carnal. There is amongst you envying, strife, division. So he's not very happy with them. Verse 17, chapter 4 says, I sent you Timotheus, who shall bring you into remembrance of my ways. They'd forgotten. Some of them puffed up. Maybe they were like some of the quotes that we read today. There's fornication amongst you. There was sexual immorality. You are puffed up. He wasn't happy with them. Brother goes to law with brother. There is utterly fault amongst you. You do wrong. Is he happy with them? Now the people out there take the Corinthian book and they build a doctrine on it, saying this is the doctrine of God, when Paul is rebuking what the Corinthians did. Interesting. What you wrote to me. Now listen to this one, how Paul is distorted. 1 Corinthians 7:1-2. Now concerning what you wrote to me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. How often is poor Paul attributed with that statement? They say Paul was terrible when it comes to women. Paul Paul never said that. Who said that? The Corinthians said it. You see, there were two sets of ideas in the Corinthian church. The one group thought that they were holy, and therefore they had to abstain from sexual encounters and from women. That is pagan doctrine. You've got it in Catholicism. It came with paganism into the church. Then there was another group in the Corinthian church which said, no, the body is holy. The body is merely a vehicle for the soul. And what you do in the body doesn't matter. You can eat and drink whatever you like. You can fornicate whatever you like. You can do whatever you like. It is holy. It's holy flesh, holy sex, holy food, holy everything. And when you die one day, you just throw off the body and you go to God. That was the other doctrine. Now, what you wrote to me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. What's that word there? But to avoid fornication, let each one have his own wife, and let each have her own husband. Let the husband give to the wife proper kindness, and likewise the wife also to the husband. Do not deprive one another. Is Paul agreeing with that statement? Yes or no?
No,
he's not agreeing with it. In fact, Paul is saying exactly the opposite. 1 Corinthians 11, 17. I praise you not that you come together not for better but for worse. I hear there are divisions amongst you. Verse 21. In eating everyone taketh before him his own supper. One is hungry, another is drunken. Despise ye the church of God? I praise you not. They were acting like pagans. They were acting like pagans. So now, what about Revelation chapter 14? Paul writes this brilliantly. He puts it into what we call an antithetical parallelism. An antithetical parallelism is where you state two opposite contrasting ideas. Number one, he quotes them and then he corrects them. He quotes them and he corrects them. He quotes them and he corrects them. He quotes an idea or something that Chloe informed him of and he corrects it. He quotes it and he corrects it. And sometimes he quotes a dictum. That is a thought that was consistent with their theology that was manifest in those days. So, it is written as how it should be, how it should not be, how it should be. 1 Corinthians 14:1, you will now know which falls where, if you know where it falls in the antithetical parallelism. Follow after charity, that's love, and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy. Desire that you can communicate the gospel. It's good to have spiritual gifts, yes. And God will give gifts to those that He wants to give them to, but desire that you can preach the gospel. That's good and right. Now, for he that speaketh in a tongue, there's no unknown in that one, he that speaketh in a tongue speaketh not unto men but unto God, for no man understandeth him, howbeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries. Now what is that? Is Paul saying this or are they saying this? You don't know. Is this something that he's quoting of theirs or is this something that Paul is stating? Well, it's a dictum. It's a Gnostic mystery dictum. In Gnosticism, this was believed, that when you were overshadowed by the god Apollo, you spoke in a mystery language to God. The Sibylline priestess did that. And the people that were slain did the same thing. In paganism you find this. Now we have to ask ourselves, Paul, do you agree with that? Because this is quoted as doctrine in the churches out there. What's that word? But! He doesn't agree with it. He that prophesies, he that preaches, speaks to men, to edification and exhortation and comforts. So, he that goes, he supposedly speaks to God, but, says Paul, he that prophesies, that preaches, he's the one that edifies and exhorts and comforts. He that speaketh in a tongue edifies himself. That's how it should not be, because love is not self-seeking. Love, the principle of love is to help others. But he that prophesies edifies the church. That's right, that's wrong. We find that in the but. That's right, that's wrong. That's right. I would that you all spoke in tongues. Dick, them all must speak in tongues. Paul does not deny them that the gift. He says, I speak in tongues. I don't mind if you all speak in tongues. But rather that you prophesy. For greater is he that prophesies than he that speaks in tongues. Except, what does it say there? He interprets. Isn't that interesting? He. Now let's say God gives me the gift of tongues. And I'm preaching in Africa or in Europe to the German nation. And I can't speak their language, and God gives me the gift of tongues, and I burst forth in tongues, and I say, Meine Damen und Herren, ich habe eine Botschaft heute Abend für euch von Gott, und es ist absolut wichtig, dass ihr diese Botschaft versteht, damit ihr gerettet werdet. And half of you say, this guy's gone nuts. And I say, what I said was, I have a message for you tonight, and it's absolutely essential that we understand this so that we might be saved. So, I'm just practicing that. There's no point in me speaking in a strange tongue, we identify tongue as a known language, without me interpreting it, right or wrong. Okay, there's nothing wrong with that. Rather show real intent. No gift is greater than another. Philo and hermeneia is quoted over here. I would that ye all speak in tongue, except that he interpret. He himself must interpret. Interpret in the Bible means either to translate, we find that in 1 John 3 verse 8, or to expound, to make something understood. It's the same word. You've got to read from the context whether it's one or the other. Now, how it should not be. Now, brethren, If I come unto you speaking with a tongue, what shall it profit you? If I speak like you say, we should speak in this unknown brabbling. Except I speak to you by a revelation, by knowledge, or by prophesying, or by doctrine. It's meaningless. For even yo, for as much as you are zealous for spiritual gifts, seek that you may excel to edify the church. Don't look for this thing that you are looking for, this manifestation that you want. Wherefore, let him that speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret. If I pray in a tongue, the unknown is not there, I'm leaving it out, it's cursive, it's not in the original. My spirit prayeth, but my understanding is unfruitful. That must be a dictum. Paul does not condemn it, for he says, what is this that you're talking about? Sounds a lot of rubbish. He says, I will pray with the spirit, but I will pray with my understanding also. So did Paul agree with this? I speak in the spirit, but I do not understand. Yes or no? No. He says, what nonsense is this? I pray with the spirit, and I will pray with my understanding also. I will sing with the spirit, but I will also sing with my understanding. I won't sing this nonsense stuff that just gets you how I wept and how I wept until I was filled with so much emotion that I crawled out of the church. Else, when thou bless with the spirit, how shall he that occupies the room of the unlearned say, Amen? At thy giving of thanks, seeing he understandeth not what thou sayest. So Paul, is he commending the strange brabbling or not? No. No. And if we know that some of the things that he is correcting come from their writings, which is obvious from what was said before, then we will not be in that trouble of misinterpreting these scriptures. We must understand, Paul, are you saying that this is right or this is wrong? Well, they listened because they had their letter and his letter, and Paul rebuked every single one of their statements, so much so that Paul was happy to write the second letter of Corinthians and says, I'm so glad that you fixed up the mess. Isn't it interesting that the world quotes 1 Corinthians and practices every single point of doctrine that Paul rebukes? Isn't that interesting? That's very interesting. For thou verily givest thanks, well, but the other is not edified. That's not how it should be. I thank my God that I spake tongues more than you all. Paul had wonderful manifestations of that. Yet in the church, I'd rather speak five words with my understanding that by my teach others also, and then 10,000 words in a tongue. Brethren, be not children in understanding, howbeit in malice, but be children in understanding. Be men. In the Lord is written, with men of other tongues and other lips I will speak unto this people, and yet for all that they will not hear me, says the Lord. Wherefore tongues are a sign, what does it say there? Not to them that believe, but to them that believe not. In other words, the gift of tongues, the gift of languages, is to preach the gospel. What they were practicing was self-satisfaction puffed up. Exactly what the Pentecostal movement is doing. It's not biblical, it's rebuked by Paul. And they quote only those portions of the scripture which are individually rebuked by Paul to substantiate their teaching. It's masterly. It's masterly. And the spirit behind it cannot be the Spirit of God. And so we could go right through this chapter and see that that is what Paul is systematically doing, taking these false manifestations apart. How is it, brethren? When you come together, everyone has a psalm, a doctrine, a tongue, a revelation, an interpretation. Let all things be done unto edifying. Everything. If any man speak in a tongue, let it be by two or at the most three, and of course let them interpret. If different language groups come together, then it is necessary, if someone has something to say, that someone interprets, that everybody might know what he's talking about. It's not about misunderstood, but if there be no interpreter, let him keep silent. What's the point of me preaching to you in German if none of you understand it? None. Let the prophet speak two or three, let every other judge see whether his speaking is right, and the things be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. So, when the gift of tongues was given in the day of Pentecost, every person was able to understand in their own language, biblical or not. Acts 2 verse 6. The gift of tongues was a real language to communicate the gospel. Yes. When the gift of tongues was being misused in the Corinthian church, Paul declared, I would rather speak five words with my understanding than 10,000 in an unknown tongue. Right or wrong? Yes, 1 Corinthians 14:19. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. 1 Corinthians 14:33. He who testifies of these things says, yea, I come quickly. Amen, come Lord Jesus. Revelation 22:20. The gospel is to be preached to the world that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world, and that we have to come back into harmony with the principles of heaven if we want to become citizens of heaven. And this message must go out into all the world, and then Jesus Christ will return. But many out there are preaching a gospel of false hope. Only believe and you will be saved. And to back it up, there are manifestations of the Spirit. And the people behind it very often are worshippers of another master, and they know it. Many out there are unknown. They don't know what they are doing. Many preachers out there have drunken this wine, and they don't know what they are doing. I'm not condemning everyone in the Pentecostal movement. I'm not condemning the people in the Pentecostal movement. But I'm saying that the manifestation that is there is not from God. And that many of the preachers will turn and find the right way if we pray for them and work for them and love them. I'm not condemning, but some of them know what they're doing. And some of them belong to organizations where they had better not belong to, because you cannot serve two masters. Thank you. Thank you.
You're watching ADTV.